There's a lot of great things happening at Tennessee Athletics.
I believe this city is going to be upside down tonight.
Season-long party continues at Rocky Top.
Welcome back, y'all, to another episode of the Everything Orange podcast. Our guest today is a fifth-year senior guard for the Lady Vols who has truly been the unsung hero for this team. She's averaged just under 10 points per game during the regular season, had her highest career rebounding average yet, collecting 25 steals on the season and 114 assists. You can find her on either side of the ball playmaking for her team while also driving to the hoop. Providing leadership and experience for this team, she will be leaving behind big shoes to fill following the end of the 2023-24 season. So please welcome to the Everything Orange podcast, Jasmine Powell. Jasmine Powell, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast today.
Thank you so much for having me.
I think of you as JP, but your nicknames are Jazz and Jazzy from home. So growing up in Detroit, can you kind of talk to me about where the love for basketball came and how it was such an important part of your upbringing?
I mean, I think my mom should be here for this conversation, honestly, because she's always telling me about the story of when she took my brother to basketball practice. And my brother, he's known to be such a social butterfly that, you know, he dropped the ball and was talking to all the parents instead. And when he dropped the ball, like, I was probably five around this time. I'm the one who ran and got the ball and brought it to my mom.
Okay.
And that's how she kind of knew, like, okay, I have someone in the family who wants to play basketball. So that's really where it stemmed from. My mom, she played when she was in high school. My dad, he played when he was in high school. And they've always been sports fans. So when I showed that interest in basketball, that's when they started, like, full out. Okay, mm-hmm. YMCA, the whole shebang. And then obviously, you know, my mom wanted me to get acclaimed to college basketball, to, you know, the WBA as well.
Yeah.
So, just watching like schools like Notre Dame mm-hmm. at the time, it was UConn that was huge. The Lady Vols, of course, but, that's really what it stemmed from me is like seeing these girls, play at the best of their ability, you know, having the skill set that, you know, at the time it was like only men would have those.
Mm-hmm.
My mom, she took me when I was, I don't know what age I was, but she surprised me to the Final Four in Tampa, Florida.
Oh, wow.
And it was Baylor, Notre Dame, UConn, and Maryland at the time.
Okay.
And Skylar Diggins was there. I mean, it was amazing. But, I mean, after that, I was like, I really want to play at this stage. I really want to go to a school that's going to get me here. So that's really where it stemmed from.
Yeah, you mentioned that you watched Tennessee growing up. What were your kind of your thoughts about the Pat Summitt era and seeing Candace Parker play, bringing home those national championships as a kid?
I mean, even in Detroit, you have, like, we had a section in class where we talked about women in sports and
wow.
Pat Summitt came up. I mean, it's not just Tennessee. And I knew that way when I was younger that, you know, her legacy and everything that she's done for Tennessee stems way beyond that. So when we talked about her, I mean, looking at her clips and everything, it's way beyond basketball for her. I mean, the things that she's done for women's sports off the court and the fact that she has really been a trailblazer in women's sports and how it's gotten to where it is now, that was something that I've always looked at and was like, okay, Tennessee is not only a basketball school, but, you know, it's a legacy for a reason for women. So that's always been a key thing that I've been looking at.
And who would have thought that it would come so full circle for you down the line? We'll get there in a second. But let's talk about the Detroit connection that you also have with Rickea Jackson on the team, because she went to Detroit Edison Public School. You went to Detroit County Day School. And I looked it up on the map. They're like 25 minutes from each other. Like, you're very close in proximity. Did you know her growing up, know her at her school, but you then also went on to play with her? So did you meet her in AAU, or did you know her beforehand?
I met her at AAU.
Okay.
I was on a completely different AAU team at the time. And I realized I wanted more competition, and I wanted to be on the EYBL circuit. So I went to the Michigan Crossovers in seventh grade, and that's when I met Kia.
Okay.
And honestly, we've been, like, friends ever since. When she was playing at DEPSA, you know, I was at Country Day, but we didn't play in the same section, like, I don't know what sector, I think.
Sure.
But, like, we played against each other. It was hilarious. She's always going to tell a story about how she beat us.
Okay.
But I'm always going to say I was injured at the time. Okay. But
yeah, that definitely had an influence on the outcome of the game.
Exactly.
Let's not be, yeah.
But, yeah, she's been my friend ever since seventh grade. I mean, our friendship blossomed in AAU. It just has continued till today.
When you did decide, let's fast forward, when you did decide to transfer to Tennessee, what were you specifically looking for out of your next school and that next opportunity?
Honestly, I wanted to go to a school that had that winning mentality, honestly. You know, coming from Minnesota, we didn't win as much, and I wanted to be on a bigger stage. I wanted to, you know, I've never been to the NCAA tournament. So going to a school that makes a tournament, going to a school that has that winning mentality of not only just winning, but, you know, fighting for a championship. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, talking to Coach Kelly, that was the first thing on her mind was, you know, do you want to win a championship? And that sparked my interest right away because, you know, she was all about, you know, I have the blueprint, I have the plan, you know. It's just, are you willing to buy in?
Mm-hmm.
And that was the only coach that I was talking to that was really about winning. It was really about winning a national championship. And so it drew me in immediately. But also, the fans and the support that you guys get here, it was like no other school that I had ever been to. So the support and, you know, the resources that they have here for women, and also like the success that they've had. You don't see a lot of schools that are, you know, quote unquote, an everything school.
Yeah.
It's mainly just basketball. It's just football, you know. So that was something that was really special to Tennessee.
And then in coming to Tennessee, you also had your hometown bestie also coming to Tennessee, mm-hmm. Coming in the same year as you. Did you guys talk about it beforehand, or did you know that this was going to happen or until you saw the announcements?
I mean, we did talk about it. I mean, we didn't know that we were going to be transferring at the same time,
okay.
Honestly. I think she went into the portal, and then a couple weeks later, I went into the portal.
Okay.
And that's when we kind of, like, connected and was like, okay, so what schools are you looking at?
Mm-hmm.
I went on my visit first here to Tennessee, okay. And then I committed first. And she was like, oh, okay, I'm just going to, like, keep going on my visit, see, like, what else is out there. And, I mean, after my visit, I knew right away I wanted to come here. So I was like, it's worth it, Kia, like, I'm gonna commit here. But I wasn't sure where her head was at yet.
Okay.
But, I mean, I still remember I was walking through Aldi at this time. You know, a big cook. But I was walking through Aldi, and my mom called me, and she was like, look at Twitter. And I looked at it, and the first thing that popped up was Kia committing to Tennessee. And I called her right away, and I was like, I started screaming in the middle of the aisle. And I was like, seriously? You didn't tell me before? But I mean, it was like, honestly, for me, it was like surreal because it's like things come back full circle.
Yeah.
And, you know, from playing in AAU, going our separate ways in college, and then being able to come back here and play like our 2 years together, it was like something I really never dreamed that would happen. But I was so glad it was with her.
Was there an extra level of comfort too, knowing that somebody who knew you during your adolescence and your growth as a kid, and also knowing your hometown and where you came from, was going to come into this next journey with you? You weren't doing it alone.
Oh, yeah. I mean, going to the transfer portal, like, you realize you have to start all over.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to make new friends. You have to get acclimated to a new city, and new coaching staff, new team. So that was one thing I knew going in that it's going to be a big hurdle for me. And so when I knew it was a chance I could play with Kia, I was like, oh, like, I have someone that could possibly come in, and like, I wouldn't be a complete stranger.
Yeah.
And, you know, if anything else went wrong, like, we have each other. So being able to have that here at Tennessee, and it's really helped me. I mean, the team has been great. I mean, I've never had that problem of, like, you know, you're by yourself or something's happened where you're, like, ostracized. But me and her both have, like, really gelled well with this team, especially last year and this year. But being able to come in and, like, have that person to lean on, whether it's with the team or, you know, if I'm feeling down by myself and she's always there to pick me up, you know, things that, you know, only your teammates will understand, but having that close relationship already with her, it really helped me, like, settle in here.
When you did come in, what was the main priority for you that you wanted to get out of this experience?
Honestly, I wanted to grow as an athlete. I wanted to grow as a student as well. There's so many opportunities here that I didn't want to just settle for just basketball. you know, the journalism route that I took. I mean, I want to do the same thing that Andrea Carter is doing. I mean, she's doing amazing. So really taking in all the opportunities that this school could give you, getting a hold of the resources that they can give you was a huge thing for me, not only with basketball-wise and being excellent at that and learning from the best and learning from someone who was coached under Pat. I mean, mm-hmm. that's in itself a blessing, and it's something that not everybody gets to have. And so just really kind of honing in on all that and taking it all in before I left was a huge thing for me.
So let's talk about your first season on Rocky Top. The team went 9-5 in conference, went all the way to the SEC championship game, and then made it to the Sweet 16 in the NCAA tournament. You mentioned it that before coming to Tennessee, you had never gone to the NCAA tournament. You never experienced getting the bid and getting your name put on the map and hopefully making a run to the championship game. Something that probably, with the history and the legacy of being a Lady Vol, is sometimes taken for granted here, because this program has gone every single year since the NCAA tournament was a thing. So for you, what did that experience mean for you to have a great season last year from start to finish?
I mean, I knew coming in that's what it is. You know, Tennessee goes to the NCAA tournament.
It's the expectation.
Exactly. Right. Right. And so, you know, you're working towards it, and you know, like, that's the goal. But then when you get there, for me, it was like, wow, like, I'm actually here. You know, this is how things work. My teammates were explaining things to me. I didn't know what was going on. I'm just, like, literally going with the flow at this point. But, you know, I'm just in awe at every stop that we made, you know, whatever, even the seating, you know, sitting down and, you know, listening for your name, when the TV's on you and you're listening for, you know, who you're going to play. And that, to me, I mean, that's my first one. So I was like, oh, my goodness, like, this is what people actually do. I'm not watching people on the TV do this, you know. So that was really, really exciting. And, you know, like you said, people do take it for granted. But it was my first one, and I was ready to sit there forever and enjoy that moment.
For you personally, that first season on Rocky Top, it was a challenging year for you on the court. You had said that your numbers weren't where they were in the past. And I want to know, in particular, through that experience, you know, it was a growing pain year for you. What did you learn about yourself last year?
Honestly, I kind of just learned how resilient I am. You know, like I said before, like, that was one of my worst, like, years in college basketball, like, mentally and physically. Like, it wasn't what I wanted it to be, and it wasn't up to par for me. So just kind of learning from that, going back, watching film, talking with coaches, I mean, really seeing, like, where the problem lies, how we can fix it the next year coming up, and just bouncing back and always, like, never, like, giving up on myself and always having that confidence. That's something that really helped me, and it really, like, showed me I can come back another year. I can, you know, kind of, like, I always call it, like, this revenge season this year, but really come back and get a redemption from last year and show, like, what I am actually capable of. I think that's something that, you know, especially seeing how this year is going for me, that I'm really proud of myself for doing.
Yeah, you call it a revenge season, but it wasn't for anybody but yourself. That was something that you wanted to do for you and leave college basketball at a different mark than it would have last year, because you did end up coming back for your fifth year of eligibility. So we kind of talked about what went into that decision, but specifically you had mentioned bouncing back and then living with no regrets in wanting to come back for that fifth year.
Yeah. I mean, I was iffy. I was like, I don't know. I mean, you always have your doubts when you have a year like that. And your confidence is, you know, off the walls. You don't know if you have it in yourself to do it another year. So coming back, I just wanted to give it, like, everything I had. You know, having no regrets, like you said, has been a really big thing. You know, when I came back and it was our first official day of practice, you know, I got a text from Coach Joy, our assistant coach, and she sent a huge paragraph of saying, you know, no regrets this year. This is your last first day of practice, official day of practice. And just remember, like, no regrets this year, and give it everything you have. And it was just a reminder to me that, you know, this is my last go around. And it's important that you, whether no matter what happens, you do this year for yourself and you know, what you have been working for this entire time.
It's been a great fifth year season for you. Mm-hmm. One of your coaches even mentioned that you've been the unsung hero in this season for the team, because I think, and you can speak to this too, the point guard doesn't always fill up the stat sheet. They do so much outside of the numbers to make the team gel and be successful on the court. So how have you seen your game grow and that confidence and that mm-hmm. maturity and being a playmaker for them?
Honestly, it stems from like the role I was given. You know, this year, the defensive, you know, role I've been given, the, you know, the leadership role I've been given, you know, last year it was kind of filled a little bit. You know, we had JoJo last year, Jordy, to fill those leadership roles. Mm-hmm. Defensively, we had Jordy as well and JoJo. So I was like, this year it being kind of on me to step up in a leadership role, vocal role, and also step up to the plate defensively for us. We needed someone to, like, guard their best guard, you know, and also meet the demands of Coach Kelly. You know, yeah. She had a brand new plan for us this year of coming in and wanting to play fast. And, you know, setting the offense is the point guard's job. So just really trying to step into that, making sure that, you know, I ask as much questions as possible to Coach Kelly, try to be, like, you know, the person on the court, the point guard on the court is, you know, extension of the coach. So always trying to make sure that I'm doing things as she would. And also, like, being my own person, you know, having that confidence to come in and that support from my teammates of, you know, we need you to be a leader right now. You know, that they're always telling me that, like, we're thankful for your leadership. And, you know, we know, like, it's hard being a point guard. They always, like, that grace is always given, and I'm very appreciative of that. So it's been great, you know, being in this role and learning, because I haven't had this role, you know, in my previous school of, like, taking on so much. Mm-hmm. So being able to come here and being able to fit in those shoes and really rise up to the plate has been everything.
Coach Harper was a point guard when she was at Tennessee. Mm-hmm. You're a point guard now in this season. Mm-hmm. How have you learned from her and even what she experienced as an athlete than being coached by her and mm-hmm. growing your game?
Honestly, one thing that she always says about, like, being a point guard is that, you know, you as a point guard, you take the least credit for wins and the most of the burden for losses. And honestly, that's so true. Mm-hmm. You know, thinking back to everything she's taught me, you know, you don't get the credit, the most credit for anything. And it's not like, you know, as a point guard, you want that or anything like that. Right. It's just that is the role that you play. And, you know, some things, like you said, like, they go unnoticed. And, you know, Coach Kelly always makes it a point to point out, like, okay, you are still doing good, even though I'm not, you know, saying specifically to you. But yeah. So just learning from her and learning, like, how to run a team and to be that leader and what to say in difficult moments, that's been key to my success this year and being that leader on the court for them, because I obviously needed all the help I could get. And so just learning from her and what, you know, was told to her from Pat and how she was successful during that time, it's really helped me to kind of flourish and try to be a more vocal leader and knowing what to say.
That's such an interesting point, you mentioning Coach Harper's just perspective on the entire thing. And it's a mentally hard place to be in. Mm-hmm. It's not something that, you know, you need that support and you need people behind you to rally behind you, because you can get in your head with something like that. You can really lock yourself down and not play mm-hmm. as free sometimes in a situation like that. So it's good to have her to lean on mm-hmm. and have that connection with her, because she understands exactly where you are.
Yeah. I mean, as a point guard, I think a lot of point guards overthink. And I am one of those people who overthink a lot. So we kind of had to just come in and, like, think of a plan of how to make the game simpler for me. Because, you know, you make a mistake, you're thinking twice about it, you're not thinking next play mentality. because you have so many things that you have to think of at once when you're a point guard. And so it's hard to just, you know, move on and not think about, you know, the mistakes that you've made, because it's really easy to, you know, come in and not being able to do your job because of how mentally, you know, flustered you are. Mm-hmm. So being able to, like you said, lean on her and lean on her for guidance during those times, during those stressful moments, especially during games, it starts in practice and being able to do that. So, yeah, I've been really grateful for her and her leadership.
A huge game that you had, you showed out in Vanderbilt, 16 points. It's all of them. 16 points, 8 assists, 5 rebounds, 2 steals. It was a huge performance for you. What did it mean to see your hard work show up in that way? Because it's not all about the stats. We've talked about that. But to see it in that game, I'm sure it really felt special for you.
I mean, yes. Going to that game, you know, we always, that rivalry that we say with Vanderbilt. But honestly, going to the game, I didn't really think of it as that. You know, going into it, saying, you know, this is just another game, trying to keep that poise about it. And then obviously we had that unfortunate thing with Kia not being able to play the rest of the game. So just having to step up in that moment, you know, I know that the team looks to me to do that sometimes. And, you know, I was, like, really proud of myself looking back that I was able to do that, because I don't think last year I would be able to do that. Okay. So, you know, looking back at those things, it's like the little things for me, you know. When you're in a shooting slump in the first half, will you shoot in the second half? It's little things like that that, you know, you look back and you see that your work and mentally, your mental work has paid off as well. So, yeah, just looking back, you know, just looking at the leadership and being able to take on that role, I mean, it was special for me.
The end of the season is closing in on us, the regular season. We've got, honestly, by the time this podcast comes out, I think that it will be onto the SEC tournament. So what are you trying to soak in these last couple of games before the postseason starts?
Honestly, the memories. I mean, there's a bunch of memories that go into games and a bunch of memories that go into practice. But honestly, every time I talk to somebody who's out of college now, they are always talking about their teammates. They're talking about, you know, the moments in the locker room that you have, the moments on the court where, you know, you're running because you turned the ball over. I mean, it's those moments with your teammates that matter the most, more than wins and losses. And those are the memories that you're going to carry. So just really trying to, like, stay present and, like, really soak in on the memories and things that we're gonna miss when we're, you know, out of here. I mean, that's really what I'm looking forward to this last couple of games.
Yeah. And then with the postseason upon us, what's this team trying to do? What's the goal in these next two rounds of tournaments that you guys are hoping to accomplish?
Well, obviously, it's to win a national championship. I mean, that is the standard here at Tennessee, and we wouldn't want anything less than that. You know, going to the Sweet 16 twice in a row last year, that, you know, we don't want it to stop there. We want to continue to keep striving for better, just to get closer and closer to the national championship, because we know we can do it. We just have to put the pieces together.
Mm-hmm. Your first year to your fifth year now, what would you tell little Jasmine, fresh coming into college, not knowing what was ahead of her, to then see yourself end up at Tennessee and playing for the Lady Vol legacy?
Honestly, I would say, like, never give up and never, like, have doubt, honestly, because coming in as a freshman, you really don't know. You know, even at Minnesota, you don't know if you're going to play. You don't know. But as I was fortunate enough to come in at, you know, in Minnesota and play. But, you know, I would say never be satisfied either, you know, to keep that same work ethic, because a time for you will come. And I think that right now, looking back, I would have never thought I would be here. So just absolutely keep working and have confidence in yourself, because, you know, there are times where you'll have those dips and those moments. So always have confidence in yourself is something I would definitely say.
And what has it meant to you to represent the Lady Fall legacy and put on the jersey and wear the Summit blue in memory of all that Tennessee has done for women's sports?
It's been a lot. You know, sometimes I find myself, like, getting ready to put on our jersey before we go out, and I'm, like, looking at the Tennessee, like, logo, and I'm looking at the Tennessee font, and I'm like, I can't believe I'm actually, like, here, and I'm about to play on this court. And it was something that you never thought I would see, you know. Looking back when I was watching the Lady Balls, I remember like specific moment where I was actually watching Megan Simmons, who just actually came and talked to us. I was watching her on the court, and they were always talking about how fast she was, and, you know, they would always show her, like, running in this, like, huge, like, Tennessee jersey, because they were, like, huge at the time, yeah. And it looked like she was just a parachute out there because she was running so fast, and, you know, looking at the jersey and realizing that you're on that same court that she was playing on, Candace Parker was playing on, I mean, all the legends that we've had come through here, it's a real moment, and it's, like, you, obviously, you never think that you're going to be in this spot, this position, but I've been really, really grateful, and it's been a blessing to be here.
Okay, so switching gears a little bit, I want to talk about a fun thing with you. We're getting away from basketball. You're really into cooking. Mm-hmm. You mentioned this. So I want to talk about, though, what shows you like that you've seen. Mm. Are you more into the cooking shows, the baking shows, Netflix? What do you watch? Because I'm sure I have an opinion on what a show you're watching.
I definitely like Chopped.
Okay.
This is pretty much a Netflix series that I'm, like, gonna go on now.
Okay.
But I do like watching both. Like, I used to watch all, like, the Gordon Ramsay shows, which are hilarious.
Yes.
But,
he's a character.
Exactly. But I really like watching Chopped. I like watching Iron Chef. That's okay. A nice one that okay. I like watching because it's just, like, all the international, like, great chefs that come together and, like, compete against each other. But I also like the baking shows too. Like, I like the silly ones, like, yeah. Nailed It. I like the professional ones. Like, what's the one I'm thinking of? It's like British.
The Great British Baking Show.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I like watching that too. Yes. Because, I mean, I think everybody is like from intermediate level to like high level is like mixed into that.
Yes.
So I mean, I like watching both of those.
That one is probably my personal favorite, and I love when they do the holiday themes. Mm-hmm. I will from October through like the start of January. That's it. It's just on the background. It puts me in the festive mood. Mm-hmm. I'm watching Halloween things, then Thanksgiving,
exactly.
Christmas. It just makes me feel good inside. I also like Guys Grocery Games. Have
oh,
you seen
okay,
that
yeah,
one?
I have.
I think that
really
one's
like
just
running around the store.
Yes. I think that's entertaining in that aspect where it's not just the cooking, but it's also like getting the ingredients together and getting tasked such weird combinations of things and trying to figure out like what to make of it. That one's fun too.
Yeah.
When you are cooking, is it just like kind of a way for you to let go of some stress and decompress from the day? Do you enjoy doing it for yourself, or is it sometimes where you're like, I don't want to touch this. I want to order takeout.
Honestly, it's kind of all of that. I do it, you know, I cook a lot for my team, you know, Kia's a person who I cook for a lot. I don't think she should be anywhere near the kitchen, her and Tamari, I don't think so. But just cooking, I like to try new things, like whether it's something I've seen on one of the cooking shows I'm watching or just having my like teammates try something I found on TikTok, you know, things like that, like desserts, cooking, like soul food is key is really like her realm is her and soul food.
Okay.
So, but I really like trying new things. And, you know, when I was a freshman, sophomore in college.
Mm-hmm.
I was given a pasta maker. So I've been making my own pasta.
That's so legit.
Yeah.
I'm jealous.
It's a blue moon type of thing because it's such
a
long process.
Yeah.
Yes. But when I do make it, it's so, so good. And it like gives
so
me
fun.
Like the Italian real
yes.
feel.
Yeah. What international food like would you love to go to travel to and get to experience authentically there?
Okay, this is gonna sound really weird, but I want to go to China, and I want to go to their moon festival, and I want to try mooncake.
Wow. That took no time for you to figure out. You're like, oh, no, this is what I've been thinking. This is my Roman Empire.
Yeah.
I want to go to China. Okay, so they have it's a moon festival,
mm-hmm.
moon cake.
Mm-hmm. So basically, it's kind of hard to explain. I'm going to tell you a backstory.
Okay.
So basically, pretty American what I'm going to say, but I was watching a show when I was younger, and it was like, Wendy Wu, I think it was.
Okay.
Like, and they had their moon festival in the show, and they were talking about how like their moon cakes is like a symbol of, you know, like what they celebrate, which is the moon. And it's basically like a pastry, and you can have like a savory one or like a sweet one. And like I tried to make one, it I'm not gonna make that again. I'm gonna leave that up to the experts but it's something that in their culture is like a really big thing for them during that time. So I definitely want to experience that, and I definitely think the people that I've talked to that have went to like the Moon Festival there, they've had a really good time. So,
well, that is so cool. Okay, Jasmine, well, last question I have for you before we wrap this up. Mm-hmm. We ask everybody on the podcast this question: when you sing Rocky Top, do you woo?
I do. That's such an odd question. Well, I guess it's right on right on top like what we're doing here, but yes, I do. I mean, that's a part of the, I feel like it's a part of the atmosphere.
It
you
is.
Have to like, and when you do it, you have to like throw your arm up.
You do.
Yeah,
you do.
So
they go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. But what's funny is like the history of it, because when they said that, when they brought it to the table, I was like, well, who doesn't woo? Like,
yeah,
what
exactly.
is, I'm like, what is so unique and what's the hot take here? Mm-hmm. But the woo wasn't a part of the original lyrics. Therefore you have like a generation that is anti-woo, and they don't woo, and they refuse to woo, and then you have like all the current athletes
yeah.
now who are like, if you don't woo, are you even a Tennessee volunteer? So
I want to know who made that up, the woo.
I do too. Where did it come from?
Exactly. Maybe. Step forward.
Well, Jasmine, thanks so much for joining me on the podcast today.
Yeah, thank
this
you
was
so
great
much.
And good luck with the rest of the season, and we wish you all nothing but the best.
Thank you so much. I love being here.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of Everything Orange. As always, be sure to follow us on all of our Vol Sports platforms so you don't miss out on a single update. But before we go, here's a look at everything going on with Tennessee Athletics, starting with tomorrow. We have so much going on around Tennessee Athletics this weekend. First, don't forget to cheer on your men's basketball team in the SEC tournament. We clinched the SEC regular season champion. Now let's continue that momentum through tournament play this weekend. Women's golf kicks off 3 days of the Mountain View Collegiate in Arizona. Track starts day one of two, competing in the UCF Black and Gold Invitational in Orlando. Women's tennis goes up against LSU at home at 4 p.m. in Barksdale Stadium. Softball hosts game one against Missouri at Sherry Parker Lee. Baseball travels to Tuscaloosa to play game one against Alabama at 7 p.m. And men's tennis hits the road to take on Texas A&M at 7 p.m. On Saturday, softball plays game two against Missouri at 2 p.m. and baseball plays game two against Alabama at 8 p.m. On Sunday, women's tennis plays Texas A&M at noon in Barksdale Stadium, while men's tennis plays LSU in Baton Rouge at 1 p.m. Softball plays game three against Missouri at 1:30 in Sherry Parker Lee, while baseball plays its last game on the road against the Tide at 2 p.m. On Tuesday, baseball hosts Xavier for its midweek game. First pitch is at 6 p.m. And lastly, on Wednesday, Swim and Dive kicks off the 2024 NCAA Women's Championships in Athens, Georgia through Saturday. Prelims are in the morning, followed by finals in the evening. Well, that's a wrap on Rocky Top. Make sure to tune in next Thursday for another episode of Everything Orange. Bye, y'all.